basically the drug discovery can be divided into two major parts. One actually is the preclinical, where actually target identification, basic research, and lead molecule is identified, and then you do a preclinical development animal model, submit your data to regulatory as the IND, that the investigational new drug filing. Then you get a permission and do the clinical development, and then you submit a new drug application filing for the marketing. And usually the entire process takes more than 10 to 15 years. It's a very long process. If you just see the scenario of the global drug discovery, and if you follow for almost 30 to 40 years, what you will find that in somewhere in 1980-90, the drug discovery was actually targeted towards disease symptom. Considering that all disease is uniform, there is a uniformity of the patient, that every patient of particular disease is same. For example, hypertension, every patient of hypertension is same. There is universal treatment. Only one treatment is for one particular disease, and mostly it is oriented to sickness. What happens now that it is now oriented towards disease mechanism, considering that there is heterogeneity of the disease, there is significant patient variability, individualized therapy, and now we are more concentrating on predictive and preventive care. So there is a significant change along with the healthcare change in the goal of the development research. Now things have been changing. With the advanced technology capability, drug discovery paradigm is shifting. And one can actually broadly find out the type of drug discovery into three. One is random. You have got a drug, you screen in the animal model as well as some of the tissue. This is very commonly done. Or you have got a drug discovery through the mechanism driven. You know some mechanism of that particular drug and then you do. Like, for example, we know that particular drug is acting on beta blocker and you do that. All ACE inhibitors all do. So this is actually mechanism driven. Then the third one is the fundamental sciences. Mostly actually this discovery is related to very commonly like hormone therapy. You have got insulin, you have got thyroxine, you have got erythropoietin, because these, we know these are the internal hormone in particular disease, they are low, we do that. So we have got main three category of drug discovery. Now one of the major thing what actually is happening, that there is a significant delay in the concept of drug finding out and then it is marketed. For example, you take random, tamoxifen. The concept was developed in 1971 and the drug was marketed in 1992, 21 years. Coming to sumatriptan, a very good drug for the treatment of migraine, concept was 1957, drug was introduced in 92, 35 years. Coming to erythropoietin, very good for the treatment of anemia, concept was 1950, drug was introduced in 1989, 39 years. So there is a significant lag time in development of drug from identification of particular concept and bringing to the market. Now let us see why. Actually, single new technology advancements is necessary, but not always sufficient to lead to an innovative pharmaceutical product. One has to remember that one technology cannot help in bringing drug very fast. So what is the necessity? That we have to convergence of technology that is needed. Now let us see how it is. Actually, presently we collect the data, do experiment, analyze a data related, and then we found it outcome. What is going to happen in future? We in fact predict the outcome. Then after predicting the outcome, we plan our experiment and then do the experiment and validate. What is commonly now is known as reverse pharmacology. Now, what are the challenges which actually the pharma industry is going to have? It is very easy to develop a drug for acute disease or chronic disease with a simple symptoms or profile or simple endpoint. For example, I want to develop a drug for hypertension. We have got a very simple method. Take a manometer, take a patient, before giving a drug, find out what is the blood pressure, give the drug, again repeat. Developing a drug for hypercholesterolemia, do the cholesterol level, give your drug, again repeat. So very simple, very easy to develop drug which those having a very simple symptom and very good endpoints. But where the problem comes? But new drug will require a new technology and new approaches for many diseases and patient stratification study. For example, cancer, diabetes, infectious diseases, sepsis, multiple sclerosis, autoimmune diseases. These are the diseases where actually we don't have very good methodology or we don't have very good endpoint. So these are the situations where really the drug discovery requires a lot of information and a lot of input and new technology. What are the opportunities for industry? First thing that there is a large number of drugs with an unprecedented number of new chemical entity will be available for investigation. It's very important that large number of products from biotechnology will be available for investigation for the pharma industry. There's a new technology for investigating complex biological system. There's a new technology for measuring the drug effect. I'll give example. Then there's a new technology for predicting the outcome. So these are actually the major challenges which the pharma industry is there, and there are some examples where these things can be achieved. So effective integration of new technology will be the key. What are the challenges? First thing that we have to have an effective acquisition and integration of technology advancement. Conversion of data from genomics, proteomics, and other high throughput data gathering technologies into medically relevant knowledge, understand the complex system and underlying the cell cycle. Successful application of that knowledge towards the improvement productivity of new drug. So these are the challenges which we are going to face. Now if you see, the human health actually depends on the very good functioning of a complex assembly like DNA should function normally to give mRNA, protein, enzyme, then there is a reactive network and cell physiology. If this is happening very well, if all the cells are working very well in a particular organ, the organ will function well. When all the functions, organs are functioning well, body will function. So the functioning of a complex assembly is very, very important for normal health. So if we hope to understand biology instead of looking for one little protein at a time, which is not how biology works, we will need to understand the integration of thousands of proteins in a dynamically changing environment. This is actually what we have to understand. Now on the potential. One thing is that the aim to improve the medicine to address. One thing is that to unmet medical need, that treatment of known diseases that are currently lack effective treatment. Secondly, treatment for diseases not yet recognized. Drug efficacy, we have to have more reliable patient response. That means whenever you are using a drug, you should be careful that it is going to respond. So responder number should be made. Then one of the very important challenge which we are going to have, that we definitely want to develop a drug which are very well safe, having a few side effects. We will take example how this is possible. Now let us see a few of the practical examples of technological advancement with implication of drug discovery and development. In case of preclinical, we have got high throughput screening technique for a quicker test. It is possible that about 10,000 compounds can be actually investigated in a week. So such a fast way you can do screening of compounds. Then using robot, the faster handling of the large number of compounds is possible. More than 10,000 compounds you can use by this technique. So very quickly actually you can screen thousands of compounds in a preclinical situation. Now we have got the microarray where it allows the parallel computation analysis of a small molecule. You can screen 10,000 of compounds simultaneously. You can screen 100 protein to protein interaction, and you can analyze more than 100 protein for drug related cells. So microarray has really contributed very significantly for our to identify a compound in a preclinical situation. Now coming to clinical. One of the very important thing is that pain. Many people would like to develop a drug in pain. Can we see pain? This is actually method MRI, very commonly used in hospital for evaluation. We have got MRI, which studies the brain structure, but we have got what is known as functional MRI, actually which studies the function. So functional MRI is really very, very helpful and contributing in advanced technology for drug evaluation. How? Actually, you can do the patient stratification, pharmacodynamic response, proof of mechanism, early phase outcome study, and surrogate marker of outcome. Let us take the example. Actually, you can use the laser beam in healthy individual to induce a controlled pain. And when the subject is getting pain, now let us see the functional MRI mapping. This is the pain. You can clearly identify and you can see the area of activation in functional MRI with the pain. When you're using a drug, fentanyl, which is a very potent energetic, you can clearly see that it is interfering. So functional MRI can be very easily used for evaluation of energetic drug in very early stage before going for clinical trial. Another one is that pain, heat pain or tense pain, again functional MRI, you can identify the area in thalamus which is activated during the pain and you can see your drug effect. In Nizam Institute of Medical Science, we use actually gamma scintillation. This is actually a technique which is used in most of the nuclear medicine department. You can find out the activation. What we did actually, we used the Coca-Cola cap, and on that Coca-Cola cap, we applied the BP cup. You increase the BP pressure. Gradually, the patient or individual gets a pain. When the individual is getting pain, we inject tritium radioactive isotope. And what you can see here, when there is no pain, there is no activation in gamma scintillography. But when there is a pain, you can find out the hot spot. So simple gamma camera, which is used by the nuclear medicine people, can be used by the healthy volunteer to detect a new analgesic drug. Another very common condition is migraine, severe pain. There are so many mechanisms out there. One of the major actually issue related to mechanism is there is significant vasodilation and temporal pulsatile pain. By our knowledge of pharmacology, we know that when patient is given nitrate, there is a vasodilatation and throbbing headache is one of the side effects. And the headache of nitrate is very, very similar to case of migraine. This information can be utilized. We have used the transcranial Doppler method. And what we did, actually, we were recording the blood flow by the middle meningeal artery. And then you give nitrate. What you get, actually, when you are giving nitrate, this is, you are getting significant increase in the blood flow. This is the drug somatriptan, which is very important anti-migraine drug. This is highly increased. But when you use somatriptan along with the nitrate, there is a blockage. And then we have got the investigative product, which has been given to you for testing. We found that it was significantly blocking the nitroglycerin induced blood volume. Again, the caliber of the again, it was significantly increased. So simply the transcranial Doppler can be used for early evaluation of anti-migraine drug. And this is the common technology used by Glaxo for their new anti-migraine drug. This is a simple method because we know that in case of migraine, we want to block vasodilatation. I told you that evaluation of anti-stress drug, anti-anxiety, that can be done in healthy subjects. This is the surrogate model. These are the different drugs. And you have got the functional MRI. You can find out the changes. In case of active drug, you are clearly able to demonstrate the effect on the brain, where in case of placebo here. So in the healthy subject, by inducing some type of stress, by functional MRI, you can detect and you can develop, identify your drug as anti-stress drug. Then one of the major problems is multiple sclerosis. Very difficult to diagnose. Clinically, very, very difficult. What happens is, clinically diagnosis is very difficult and the life expectancy of the patient after diagnosis is about 5 to 10 years. Very common in females.
What happened? This is the function MRI, surrogate marker. There is a decrease in the blood volume, there is inflammation, and there is action. So these are the, what you are seeing, the yellow is nothing but the inflammatory changes which is there. This one actually the brain volume, gradually the brain volume comes down and then axonal loss. So these are the three fundamental things which happens in the brain, and these three fundamental things you can find out with MRI. Now let us see how it is possible. Actually in multiple sclerosis, Stroop test is given. Stroop test is nothing but a type of challenge which is actually given to individual in form of actually mathematical calculation, or you can do further on anything. So when you actually stimulate the brain, you are able to, in case of multiple sclerosis, what happens that whenever you are doing that, you are able to get an abnormal activation. This is very diagnostic in case of multiple sclerosis in function MRI. Same thing, multiple sclerosis patient, there is a lot of actually activation. What is there? Here actually we have got healthy volunteers because there is nothing in their condition, there is no activation, but in patient there is a lot of activation when they are on placebo, but once they are given a drug like rivastatin, there is significant decrease in activation. By this method, by using functional MRI, in very early stage you can find out the drug for multiple sclerosis before going for clinical trial. Another very important condition, that Alzheimer's disease. We know that Alzheimer's disease is mostly because of the deficiency of acetylcholine, and PET scan can be used to identify. This is the normal control and this is the patient with Alzheimer's disease. Even there is actually now their memory testing, the functional MRI scheme also has come, which is very rarely used. In Nizam Institute of Medical Sciences, we have developed a computerized based test model mostly for the immediate and the recall memory, and this we have used for actually detection of very early in the patient with Alzheimer's disease. This is totally compromised and we have used very effectively for detecting. This has got various psychomotor tests, but I am talking because in relation to Alzheimer's disease, which is having a memory test in this. Then coming to PET scan, this is very important thing, that sensitivity specificity. PET scan actually is sensitive for many of the places, for example, identifying detection, molecular pathway, drug distribution, metabolism, physiology, and structure. Now, let us see. Actually, one can use PET scan in very early drug development to find out tissue distribution, tissue blood flow, function of neurotransmitter, pharmacodynamic effect, and pharmacokinetic. Many of the centers now very, very commonly using PET scan in very early stage of drug development. For example, this is, now we know very well that in case of bronchial asthma, when we are using a spacer device, the drug which is reaching into lung is more as compared to non-spacer. So now spacers are recommended to be used as a patient with bronchial asthma to inhale corticosteroid, and this is the evidence. Very clearly demonstrating that when you are using spacer device with the PET scan, you are able to demonstrate that concentration of that drug is much more as compared to that. Now coming to adenosine, again the myocardial infarction is one of the very common. Clearly you can demonstrate whether your drug is increasing the blood flow into myocardium or not by using adenosine method. Again myocardial perfusion. So if you have got any drug which is for angina pectoris, very easily you can demonstrate whether it is increasing the blood flow or not by using PET scan. Again, for the cancer treatment, one can use PET scan to identify this is before and this is after. Then everybody is talking diabetes. I thought why I should lose the chance of talking diabetes.
Sir, the time. The time.
How much time?
You can summarize.
You have to go for amputation. The reason is that in case of neuropathy, there is loss of all the sensation like temperature, pain, touch, and vibration. But as our knowledge goes, that in case of diabetes neuropathy, very
very early change is actually loss of vibration threshold. It goes very early, but in late stage, actually, there is loss of pain, temperature, and then patient develops. There is a neuroestimation meter by which actually you can detect early neuropathy by recording the vibration threshold. So we have used this technique of vibration threshold. You apply actually, this is the transducer you apply onto the bony surface, and gradually you increase the voltage. And as soon as the subject feels the vibration, that is actually vibration threshold potential, you find out. This is the study which we have done by using GLA, and we have clearly demonstrated that the 2-year treatment of GLA significantly decreased the vibration threshold threshold. In case of control, it is less. In case of patient diabetes, it is very high. So by using only the vibration threshold, you can detect very early neuropathy in case of diabetes. And you can see, because this is the place, this is the time where actually treatment of these drugs may be effective. But it becomes chronic, it is very difficult. And even actually that this genome has increased, and people say that by year 2020, you may be going to the pharmacy with your Aadhaar card and ATM card and genome card. And they may decide which drug you want to use. Coming to treatment compliance, again, this is another device. Then somebody is covering organ chip. I don't want to say this is one of the very good techniques. Now most of the organs are available on chip, where actually you can use them for preclinical evaluation. And finally, what I want to say that the technology like molecular imaging, PET scan, functioning MRI, molecular diagnosis, genomic, all these or through this structure evaluation is going to contribute very significantly in promoting the drug discovery and development.
I'm sorry for a nice lecture to cut short only due to time. Only quick question, please. One. And already. Thank you, Professor Naidu, for an excellent exposition of this modern techniques to deal with the all this problem of the patients. Thank you. Thank you.
Let's hear loudly for Professor Naidu.